if you look at a decision maker, say a scout in a professional league, going and watching a player and saying, oh, is this player good? What are they looking at? They're looking at the objective data. How many baskets did they score? How many things did they do? What are they doing when they make the judgment? They're not just translating the objective data. They're adding their own intuition. In doing so, every piece of psychology tells us they're also adding their own bias. People, when looking at people or looking at anyone and making judgments, tend to make judgments that are stereotypical, that tend to make judgments that reflect their prejudices. So algorithms don't have any of that. They're going to reflect the bias in the data, but they're not going to add to it. Humans, on the other hand, take the data and then add an extra layer of bias. And so one of the biggest advantages of algorithms in promoting equity is that they remove that one layer. That doesn't mean they don't have other problems, but those problems are manageable, and at least we're starting in a place closer to an objective, fair reality. Yeah, one of the unfortunate things is if we know that the algorithm is biased because the data is biased, we might say, well, let's get unbiased data. Practically speaking, that's very unlikely to happen. And even if you happen to be in a particular example where the data happens to be unbiased, it's just a faulty way of thinking. I kind of think of this as akin to fraud. Any good financial system, auditing system, accounting system, is always alive to fraud. Even if you put in a bunch of security checks and balances to make things work, you will always be live to fraud. And I think in building algorithms, we have to have a similar attitude. We're never going to have a situation free of bias. We always need to be alert to the bias in the data. Yeah, so and as you're building these algorithms, or you're using them, or you're designing them, I think there are several ways that you can be alert to bias and resolve it. I think the first and foremost is just to ask the question, what are all the ways in which the outcome that the algorithm is predicting doesn't match the outcome of interest? Because it's never exactly the same. You have an outcome in the data set, and the outcome might be, oh, did a customer click on a link? That's not the outcome you care about. You care about, was the customer happy with the experience, or did it induce them to buy more of the product? So the difference between the thing we want to predict and the thing that we measure, that's one big source of bias. So even just asking the question, what are we predicting, what are we thinking we're predicting, and what's the difference between those, is, I would say, one of the first things that people can do. The second thing that people can do is to look at the output of the algorithm and actually ask, okay, well, this algorithm, how many of this group does it hire, and how many of this group does it hire or choose or predict? And by comparing it, the outputs, we can ask, wait, if there's a disparity, is there a reason for that disparity? Is that the algorithm adding some bias? So I think both by looking at the inputs and then looking at what it produces, we can be very alert to, okay, was this a result of bias, or is it something more structural upstream from the algorithm? When we use the word fairness, we mean lots of different things. For example, we might want the two people who look similar should be treated similarly. An alternative that you might want is that you might want that after the fact, we wouldn't want people who committed a crime, say, to be released at different rates if they're black than white. So one is after the fact, one is before the fact. And you can imagine coming up with these kinds of notions of fairness, and you would imagine you want all of them to be true. And in fact, when you look at how people evaluate algorithms, someone might use one kind, another person might use another kind. What we show is that actually these three are actually all in conflict, and you can't have all of them. And so that illustrates, I think, one of the recurring themes in this fairness literature, is that when you start to model these things kind of carefully, there are trade-offs. There is no easy way to get all the things that you want. So we all understand that there might be a trade-off between fairness and efficiency, but it's more basic than that. There are trade-offs between the different kinds of fairness we want, and there are trade-offs between fairness and simplicity. And so I think this next generation of literature is making it clear unfairness is not something that we can just say, oh, we want to mete it out all the time. It comes at costs, and there's no way to get everything that you want. I think that the places where its algorithms have shown and people are most worried about bias are actually also the places where algorithms have the greatest potential to reduce bias. So I'll give you two examples. Take hiring. Hiring is a place where we're worried that, oh, the underlying data is biased, so the algorithm will be biased. And that's fair. But hiring is also the place where study after study has shown humans add a tremendous amount of bias in which resumes to look at, which people to hire, conditional on the resume, et cetera, et cetera. So, and that bias is in addition to whatever was in the data. So if you take something like hiring, it's ironically the places where we worry algorithms will be biased are also the places where they have the most potential to remove a lot of the biases of humans. Same in the criminal justice system. It's reasonable that people are worried algorithms in the criminal justice system might add bias, and we should worry about that and find ways to deal with it. But we have to remember that all of the literature to date has actually shown there's an enormous amount of human bias that's added to any decision. And so, again, even though we're worried about bias by algorithms, it's the bias by humans that makes this a great opportunity. And so as a result, there's this perverse set of circumstances where we should remember that the places where the data is the most biased, which is where humans are adding a lot of the bias, is the place where we should look to properly built algorithms to get rid of bias. So it's kind of a perverse state of affairs. When we think about whether AI will promote equity, I think one of the things I'm always think back to is people want to anthropomorphize technologies, especially these sort of artificial intelligence technologies. And I think in part because it has the word intelligence in it. People want to imagine these tools will have their own intelligence or humanity almost. And so they want to know what these tools will do. But ultimately, they're just tools. So whether AI in any context, system, social system, company, whether it promotes equity or not, is going to simply be a consequence of the intentions of the people building these algorithms and their knowledgeability. I think the science is moving forward that we can make the builders of these tools knowledgeable enough about the biases and everything that can happen and how to fix them, so that in 10 years, what we're left with is intention. If people want to use these tools to promote inequity, they will promote a great deal of inequity because you can do more harm with this tool than you could just by yourself. If people want to use these tools to promote equity, they will be able to promote a great deal of equity. So whether algorithms ultimately are good for equity or bad for equity, ultimately simply comes down to the human motives and desires and regulations we put on people. It's not going to be a technological problem. It's going to be ultimately just a sociological problem.